Good morning, everyone. I am Dr. Ganesh Kimje. I am working as a assistant professor in the department of the organ transplant anesthesia and critical care at Mahatma Gandhi Hospital and Medical College, Jaipur. ABG nowadays is one of the routine investigation we come across during a perioperative management of any patient. So it is important to know the how to analyze any ABG report. So basically ABG provides the rapid information about the three basic a physiological process, that is oxygenation, valvular ventilation, and acid-base balance. The oxygenation is provided by the PO2 level. The alveolar ventilation is provided by the PaCO2 level, and acid base balance is provided by the pH and bicarb. So the indication of doing ABG during a perioperative period is to when we need to assess oxygenation and ventilatory status of the patient, like during preoperative assessment, if a patient with severe COPD or a post COVID patient who is on a ventilator and come to you for upper GIS surgery, then you can call for the ABG analysis for the better assessment of the oxygenation and ventilatory status of the patient along with the routine pulmonary function test. The ABG also helpful to need to assess the acid-base status of the patient. For example, on postoperative day 6 of the Whipple's, if patient develop pneumonia and septic shock, then you should call for the ABG to assess the oxygenation as well as the acid-base status of the patient to know the severity of the pneumonia and septic shock. ABG also helpful to assess the response to any therapeutic intervention like ventilatory management or any circulatory management. It is also helpful to assess the prognosis of the disease process, like when you found any oxygenation and ventilatory abnormality of the patient in the patient, or you find patient is having lactic acidosis, and you act on the patient by giving physiotherapy or incentive spirometry or giving fluid or giving a circulatory intervention like starting of NORAD or vasopressors, then you need to repeat ABG after 2 to 3 hours to assess your response to the therapeutic intervention. And if patient responds to your therapeutic intervention, then prognosis is good for the patient. Or if a patient is going bad or acidosis get worse, then patient is not responding to your given line of treatment. So next step is to differentiate between the ABG and BBG value. The then normal pH of ABG report is 7.36 and 7.44. A PO2 level is around 80 to 100 and a PACT level is around 35 to 45. The venous blood sample is slightly more acidotic as compared to arterial blood sample. The best way to differentiate between ABG and BBG is by looking the PO2 level, which is around 40 in BBG and which is around 18 ABG. So the next step is to evaluate is this ABG report is valid or not. So like if some patient is having PS 7.3 CO260 and bicarb is 30. So by modified Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, the hydrogen ion concentration is calculated by the formula 24 into CO2 divided by the bicarb level. The CO2 and bicarb level we get from the ABC report. Then after modification of this formula, the bicarb concentration into hydrogen ion concentration into bicarb divided by CO2, which must come around 24. And this hydrogen ion is calculated by looking at any pH level, pH level from the ABG. If a patient is having pH 7.4, his hydrogen ion concentration in body is around 40. If patient is having pH 7.3, hydrogen ion concentration is 50, and if pH is 7.2, hydrogen ion concentration is around 60. So by fitting this value in this formula, our patient pH is 7.3, then hydrogen ion concentration is around 50. So when you enter in this value in our report, the 50 into 30 by 60, 30 is the bicarb concentration and 60 is the CO2 level, which come around 25, means this patient ABG report is valid. Means there is no problem with this machine. Sometimes when you found that when machine is not properly calibrated, we will get the invalid ABG report. So before assessing any ABG report, it is best to assess the ABG validity. The hydrogen ion concentration simply calculated by subtracting the last pH decimal from the 80. Like if a patient is having pH 7.40, then 80 minus 40 is equal to 40. If a patient pH is 7.3, then 80 minus 30 is 50. The hydrogen ion simply calculated by subtracting the decimal value from the 80. So let's move to the how to interpret any oxygenation and ventilatory status of the patient. This is the oxygen cascade. The oxygen is moved from the high atmospheric pressure to the low atmospheric pressure to this cellular level. At the level of C, the partial pressure of oxygen is around 160, which is 21% of the normal atmospheric barometric pressure. In respiratory tract, it get humidified with the water vapor pressure. So the partial pressure of oxygen is dropped to 149 mmHg. In the level of alveoli, the air get mixed with the carbon dioxide, which is exhaled from the lung during expiration process. So partial pressure of oxygen it drops at the level of alveoli, which is around the 99 mmHg, which get obtained by this alveolar gas equation, which is 760 means atmospheric pressure minus 47 is water vapor pressure into fractions of inspired air gas, that is 0.21 for normal room air minus PaCO2 divided by R is the respiratory caution. So it is approximately 99 mmHg. Partial pressure of oxygen in alveoli, which is around 99 mmHg in normal healthy human patient who is breathing on room air. So this partial pressure of alveoli is calculated from the ABG value, which is approximately five times the fraction of inspired oxygenation concentration. So after this, oxygen moves from the alveolar capillary membrane into the systemic circulation, and which is having partial pressure of oxygen is around 95 mmHg, and the cellular partial pressure is around 20 mmHg. So if any pathology process involving alveoli or alveolar capillary membrane any pathology process in affecting alveolar or alveolar capillary membrane affect the passage of oxygen from the alveoli into the systemic circulation. So the gap between the alveolar partial pressure of oxygen and systemic artery partial pressure of oxygen is widened, which is called alveolar arterial oxygen pressure gap. This is normally 10 to 20 mmHg, and it get widened in parenchymal lung diseases. So while assessing the oxygenation status of the patient, it is first we have to calculate the what is the pressure partial pressure of the oxygen in the alveoli. And second one, you have to get the PO2 level from the ABG report. And if that gap get widened, then patient is having some parenchymal lung disease. Next step is to calculate the PO2 by FR2 ratio, that visually called a P by F ratio. This is normally more than 300. Like a normal PO2 is around 80 to 100, and normal room air FR2 is around 0.21. So it become more than 300 in normal healthy patient. If PY ratio is decreased, which is around 200 to 300, the patient is having mild acute respiratory distress syndrome. If PY ratio is around 100 to 200, the patient is having moderate ARDS, and PY ratio is less than 100, the patient is having severe ARDS.
Before you move on, I think the alveolar oxygen concentration, you told us how to calculate it.
Yes, sir.
But you said it is roughly five times the FIO.
Yes, sir.
But that is assuming normal airways.
Yes, sir, normal
so
airways.
When there is airway disease, so is there a direct way of directly measuring alveolar oxygen rather than only by calculation?
Sir,
bronchospasm or lung collapse, atelectasis because of plugs in the airways, alveolar oxygen will be low. So it may not be just 5 times FiO2.
Sir, the best way to, this is the alveolar gas equation. We can calculate the PO2 level by this alveolar gas equation by measuring PaCO2 level. So
PaCO2,
sir, from ABG sample. So, sir, this is the alveolar gas equation. We can calculate the partial pressure of oxygen in alveoli by this equation. by looking at the ABG.
So you mean the PaCO2 level will be higher, and accordingly you will be able to adjust on the
adjust. Yes, sir.
So not by the approximate method, but exact mathematical calculation.
Yes,
with
sir.
The PaCO2 value, you will get the alveolar oxygen.
Yes, sir. Sir, we get the alveolar oxygen.
Thank you,
sir. I tell just simple method to calculate the PaO2 level by looking at the FiO2.
Right. Got it.
Because it is very difficult to get that a mathematical calculation for analyzing every ABG report.
And the R value is fixed. You always use the respiratory quotient.
Yes, sir. Pointed, sir.
It's always pointed.
Yes, sir. It's always fixed.
Thanks.
So by looking at the ABG, we can differentiate between the type 1 and type 2 respiratory failure. Like type 1 is the hypoxic and type 2 is the hypercapnic respiratory failure. In type 1 respiratory failure, the PO2 is low, PaCO2 is not elevated, and AA gradient is widened. In type 2, that is hypercapnic respiratory failure, the PO2 is low, PaCO2 is elevated, and AA gradient is normal. So the example of type 1 respiratory failure are atelectasis abscess, pneumonia, ARDS, pulmonary edema, and embolism. The example of type 2 respiratory failure are any CNS depression, like sedative agents, cerebral vascular episode, or any spinal cord or peripheral nerve disorder, like GP syndrome, or any neuromuscular disorder or kyphoscoliosis. So let's find out what's the abnormality in this patient. This is the patient, Mr. Srijan, who is having acute respiratory distress, and the patient is on BiPAP support with air. FiO2 of 40%, PPOP 6, and pressure support at 10. When you start the assessment of the oxygenation status, first you have to find out the PO2 and PaCO2 level. So in this patient, PO2 level is 59, means it's very low. PaCO2 is 37.9, means it's normal. PO2 levels mean partial pressure of the gas oxygen at the alveolar level is calculated by the multiplying by the 0.4 is the partial fractions of inspired oxygen concentration into 713 is barometric pressure minus water vapor pressure, and 38 by divided by 8. 38 is the PaCO2 level, which comes to the 245. Roughly, we can say five times of the fractions of five times the FiO2 level, which comes at around 200. So in this patient, AA gradient is widened, which is around 180, 185. So patient is having parenchymal lung diseases. And by looking at PaO2, PaCO2, and AA gradient, the patient is having type 1 respiratory failure. And when we calculate the PaO2 by FiO2 level, which comes to 150, means patient's severity is moderate. So let's move toward how we interpret acid-base status of this patient. It is best to assess the acid-base status of the patient by moving stepwise manner. So these are the 7 steps. We start learning how to interpret the acid-base status by looking into each step. So before going into analysis of ABG report, we have to find out what is the normal value. The normal value of the pH is 7.35 to 7.45. A PaCO2 normal value is 35 to 45, and BICARB normal value is around 22 to 26. But for the calculation purpose, we take the pH 7.4 is normal, a PaCO2 40 is our normal value, and BICARB 24 is our normal value. first step is to find if patient is having acidosis or alkalosis. The normal value is 7.4. If pH is less than 7.4, the patient is having acidosis, and if patient's pH is more than 7.4, the patient is having alkalosis. For example, if a patient is having pH 7.3, CO2 60, and bicarb 30, means patient is having acidosis. There are the two components of acid-base balance. First is respiratory, which can calculate by the pH CO2 level, and second component is metabolic, which can be evaluated by the bicarb level, and both these components simultaneously acting on the pH to maintain the pH value around 7.4. So if patient is having pH CO2 less than 35, if patient is having pH CO2 less than 40, we call it at metabolic alkalosis. If patient is having pH CO2 more than 40, we call it at the respiratory acidosis. And if a patient is having bicarb less than 24, we call it at metabolic acidosis. And if patient is having bicarb more than 24, we call it at metabolic alkalosis. Like in this patient, the pH 7.4, CO2 60, and bicarb is 30. CO2 is 60 means the patient is having respiratory acidosis, and bicarb is more than 24 means patient is having metabolic alkalosis. So patient is having respiratory acidosis and metabolic alkalosis. So in these two parameter, first one must be a primary component, and second must be compensatory component. The primary component is decided by the which move in the direction of the pH. Means if patient pH is 7.4, less than 7.4, means patient is having acidosis. The component which move toward the acidosis is your primary component. The second component that move opposite to your pH is compensatory component. Like for example, if a patient is having pH more than 7.4, and means patient is having alkalosis, and patient pH CO2 is less than 40, means patient has alkalosis, respiratory alkalosis, then primary component become respiratory alkalosis, which is compensated by the metabolic acidosis. In the same way, if a patient pH is less than 7.4, means patient is having acidosis, and the bicarb level is less than 24, means patient is having metabolic alkalosis. Metabolic acidosis means your metabolic component is your primary component, and the rest component is your compensatory component. Like in this patient, the pH is 7.3, CO2 60, and bicarb 30. pH is 7.3, patient is having acidosis. So your respiratory acidosis is become your primary component, and then metabolic alkalosis is your compensatory component. What is meant by compensation? In the presence of acidosis or alkalosis due to the primary component, the other components will move in the opposite direction in an attempt to minimize the effect on the pH. Means if patient is having primary respiratory acidosis, his compensatory component become metabolic alkalosis. If patient is having metabolic acidosis, the compensatory component become respiratory alkalosis. And in the same way, if patient is having respiratory alkalosis, the compensatory component become metabolic acidosis. And if patient is having metabolic alkalosis, the compensatory component become respiratory acidosis.
मैं मूव करें स्लाइड स्टॉप शेयर करके दोबारा करें
यस
Justin, can I ask you a quick question?
Yes, sir.
See, you talked about validity calculation in the beginning about the arterial blood gas values, and now you're talking about interpreting the acid-base balance. All this is on the ABG.
ABG, sir.
How about doing it? Is it going to be similar if you do it in the VBG? Because normally we've been kind of very roughly using arterial blood gases for oxygenation status.
Yes,
I'm not really interested only in the acid base. Will VBG, all this, what you told us, will it apply equally well to venous blood gases?
Sir, in VBG report, we can't assess the oxygenation status of the patient.
Agreed.
But
acidosis, we can assess for the ABG acid-base balance.
We can assess the acidosis component of the patient on looking at the VBG, but VBG is slightly more acidotic than arterial blood. We have to keep in mind that the VBG is always slightly more acidotic than the arterial blood.
But the formula will be same.
Yes, sir.
And the values will be accordingly of the state. जो उसका हाइड्रोजन का और उसका दोनों का वैल्यू आपने 2-4 दिया CO3 का उसमें और भी मतलब वो कम हो जाएगा क्या नाम है इन बीबीजी विल बी इवन स्टेबल
यस सर स्लाइड नॉर्मल बीबीजी स्लाइटली एसिडोटिक मोर एसिडोटिक देन बीबीजी सो द द सैंपल बिकम मोर एसिडोटिक और मोर अल्कोहलिक बीबीजी सैंपल अकॉर्डिंगली So there are certain rules for the compensation. So if primary component is the respiratory, then metabolic component is the compensatory component. If respiratory disturbance is acute, means if respiratory disturbance happened less than 24 hours ago, the pH changes by 0.1 for every 10 changes in 10 mm of changes in the PSU2 level. Or changes of 1 milliequivalent of bicarb for every 10 changes in PSU2 level. If patient is having acute respiratory disturbance. If patient is having chronic respiratory disturbance, the pH changes less than 0.1 for every 10 mm of Hg changes in PSU2 or bicarb changes by 3-4 milliequivalent for every 10 mm of changes in PSU2. Like in this example, the patient pH is 7.3, PSU2 60 and bicarb 30. Patient is having primary respiratory acidosis. So the PSU2 changes by 20. So pH must, if this is the acute respiratory disturbance, the pH should be around 7.2, but it is 7.3, mean patient is having chronic respiratory disturbance. Thus, same with the bicarb, the pH, the bicarb changes of more than 3-4 milliequivalent, 3-4 for every 10 mm of Hg changes of CO2 level. So this patient is having chronic respiratory disturbance.
ये जो last line है, expected SpO3 in chronic change.
Yes sir.
Is 24+6. वो तो 30 तो हो गया.
Yes sir.
But how or 8? What means by 8?
Sir plus 3-4 sir.
3-4.
3-4 sir.
3-4. Oh. So मतलब तो ये और वो तो slides कर देते
हैं 30-32 ये so I think you're talking about the acute change
so
often it is clinically apparent whether this is acute or this is a patient has underlying COPD in fact more commonly we have a situation of an acute worsening in a COPD patient
yes sir
so it's an acute on chronic worsening in that situation the same numbers and calculation will apply
Sir, it will not get applied, sir. Sir,
applied.
Yes, sir. If patient come to you with severe, first time if patient come to be severe respiratory distress, then when you analyze ABG, then you come to know that this acute respiratory distress is acute or happen in less than 24 hours or more than 24 hours.
I mean, that's based on the history.
Yes, so
that's what you're trying to tell us. Based on ABG, how will you differentiate between acute deterioration and a chronic deterioration, a chronic situation?
Sir, patient is having respiratory disturbance less than 24 hours or more than 24 hours. We can get it from the ABG. The history might get different because if some patient feel respiratory rate 30 is normal, some patient may feel respiratory 30, yeah, is patient like is having COPD respiratory distress.
The values will be different from the normal people.
Thus, COPD is a totally a different thing, sir. COPD is so always having PaCO2 more than
COPD. So we'll have to have a separate discussion for COPD.
Yes, sir.
For this, we just refer to people with previously healthy lungs.
Healthy lungs and we have an acute respiratory disturbance.
Or duration of 24 hours. And that the respiratory symptoms patient complains is 24 hours. But your analysis tells you that this is probably a chronic condition.
Chronic condition.
Based on the bicarb and the... Okay, got it. Thank you, sir. For the
information. Dinesh, I think that suggestion of Dr. Chaube is very good. In the last line, we change it to 24 plus 6.
Is equal to 30/32.
No problem.
But I was very okay. Secondly, already to Professor Sarswat's question. Now, suppose we have a baseline value of a patient who has a COPD.
Yes, sir.
And then he comes to the because ICU in a hospital, a COPD patient stays whatever life he's carrying on at home. He comes to the hospital only when he deteriorates.
Yes, sir.
So can then with that if we have a standard value is value before the acute episode, and then we apply this acute formula? Can we say that
sir, this formula cannot apply to COPD patient because the COPD patient having baseline PaCO2 is more than 40 and oxygen concentration is always low, which is around 70 or 80.
Exactly. Generally, people don't, even COPD people don't carry ABG reports around.
Yeah.
They usually don't have
we can calculate it, sir, acute deterioration on COPD by looking at the previous ABG report and analyzing the recent ABG report. We can say that patient is having acute respiratory.
Exacerbation
on COPD.
So it looks like we'll have to have a separate class on ABG interpretation in COPD patients. So we'll leave it to that. Let's leave go ahead.
So the compensation for respiratory is metabolic acidosis. For respiratory acidosis less than 24 hours, there is one changes of bicarb for every 10 increase in the PaCO2. For respiratory acidosis more than 24 hours, there is 4 changes in bicarb for every 10 increase in the PaCO2 level. In respiratory alkalosis, which is less than 24 hours, there is 2 changes in bicarb for every 10 changes in PaCO2. And for respiratory alkalosis more than 24, there is 5 changes in bicarb for every 10 changes in PaCO2. These are the references value. We can say 1 to 2 or 3 to 4 or 2 to 3 or 4 to 5. There is rule for the metabolic component also. In metabolic components, the compensation is respiratory. Rule of thumb is for there is change of 1 mmHg of PaCO2 for every change of 1 milli equivalent in bicarb. Means if bicarb is falling, normal value is 24. If patient bicarb is 22, then patient PaCO2 become 38. For two changes in bicarb will cause two changes in the PaCO2 level.
Yeah, the compensatory that will increase.
The exact calculation is by the Winter formula. For metabolic acidosis, the expected PaCO2 is equal to 1.5 into bicarb plus 8 plus or minus 2. And for metabolic acid for metabolic alkalosis, the expected PaCO2 is 0.7 into bicarb plus 21 plus or minus 1.5. So the easy way to calculate the changes in CO2 is by this simple method. So checking for decomposition, if some patient is having PA 7.3, PA CO2 35 and bicarb 18, the expected PA CO2 is the bicarb falls 24 minus 18 is 66. The bicarbs fall by 6 milliequivalent per liter. So the PaCO2 must be around 34 or 35. The patient is having PaCO2 is 35, means compensation is as per expected compensation.
There can never be overcompensation.
Sir, there can be overcompensation. Sir, I will come to the next slides. So if compensation as per calculation, then patient is having single acid base disorder. If compensation is less than or more than the expected value, then the patient is having dual or multiple acid base disorder. Like some patient is having lactic acidosis, also some also having metabolic keto acidosis also. Then by this compensation we can come to know that patient is having other than the single acid base disorder. The next thing while analyzing ABG is to calculate the ionic gap, which is a difference between the cations and anions. The simple way is to calculate sodium minus chloride plus bicarb, which is normally around 12. If ionic gap is more than 12, the patient is having high ionic gap acidosis. If patient is having ionic gap less than 12, the patient is having non-ionic gap acidosis. If a certain patients is having low albumin level, the ionic gap it adjusts according to the albumin level. We have to add 2.5 for every 1 gram per dl fall in albumin level. The normal albumin level is around 4 gram per dl. So the example of high ionic gap acidosis are ketoacidosis, like the diabetic starvation and alcoholic ketoacidosis, lactic acidosis, uremia, or any toxins like methanol, ethyl glycol, propylene glycol, or salicylate drug-induced metabolic acidosis. The example of normal ionic gap acidosis, if patient is having hypokalemia, then the causes are GI losses of bicarb, like in ureteric diversion, diarrhea, is patient with diarrhea, or the patient having ileostomy, or patient may having renal loss of bicarb in proximal renal tubular acidosis, or the patient is on carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. If potassium is normal, then normal ionic gap acidosis is found in acutubular necrosis and distal renal tubular acidosis. We can calculate the delta ratio also. Delta ratio is ratio of the increase in ionic gap divided by the decrease in the bicarb. The increase in means normal ionic gap is 12 and normal bicarb is 24. So if some patient is having PS 7.2, PS 25, bicarb 10, sodium 131, and potassium 6.6, chloride 8, 98.3. So patients ionic gap is sodium minus bicarb plus chloride, it comes to 22.7. means increase in the ionic gap is calculated by subtracting 12 from the 22.7, and decrease in bicap is calculated by subtracting 10 from the 24. So it becomes 0.76. If delta ratio is less than 1, which suggests a greater fall in bicap than expected changes in ionic gap, then patient is having additional metabolic acidosis, mostly renal cause. If delta ratio is more than 2, which indicates the lesser fall in bicap than expected, the patient is having additional metabolic alkalosis. This all calculation for dual all of multiple acid-base disturbance. So these are the 7-step approach we just gone through. So let's come to the example how we calculate the how we can analyze any ABG report. This is the ABG of the patient post liver transplant. On day one, patient is on intubated on mechanical ventilator with FiO2 40%, PPOP 5, respiratory rate of 18, and tidal volume of 480. While looking at the ABG patient, PaO2 is 139 and PaCO2 is 31. So his partial pressure of oxygen at the alveoli is around 40 into 5, which is 200. And then alveolar arterial gap becomes 60, 200 minus 140 means 16, means 60 means patient is having some parenchymal lung disease. As this patient is intubated, so patient might having some basal atelectasis. And PO2 by FiO2 ratio is, PO2 is 140 and FiO2 is 0.4, which is around more than 300, means it is normal. So the first step is to analyze the whether this ABG report is correct or not. The patient pH is 7.3, so the hydrogen ion concentration is around 50. 80 minus 30 is equal to 50. The 50 into bicap concentration divided by the PaCO2 level, which come to the 25, means which is around 24 plus minus 2, means this patient is having valid ABG report. The pH is 7.3, means acidosis. CO2 is 31, means patient is having respiratory alkalosis. pH bicap is 16, means patient is having metabolic acidosis. The primary component is the component which move in the direction of pH, means patient is having metabolic acidosis, which is compensated by respiratory alkalosis. So next step is to move for the compensation. The expected PaCO2 is calculated by this Winter formula, or we can calculate by the simple method. There is changes of one changes of bicarb for every 10 changes in the CO2 level. So expected PaCO2 is around 32 plus minus. So expected PaCO2 is 32. So now patient is having PaCO2 is 31. So means the compensation as per expected means patient is having single acid base disorder. Next step is to calculate the ionic gap, which is sodium minus bicarb plus chloride, which is around 13, means patient is having high ionic gap acidosis. The lactate is on higher side, which is around 9, means patient is having lactic acidosis. Delta ratio is less than 1, means patient is also having some renal components for acidosis.
Manish, I think we have to leave some time for the students if they want to ask something. We have more examples, or?
Sir, there is two more examples.
We are now 8 minutes, 5 minutes. Maybe just touch the basic things without going into.
Yes, sir. advanced interpretation. So while looking at this ABG report, patient pH is 7.5, means patient is having alkalosis. PaCO2 is 30, means patient is having respiratory alkalosis. And bicarb is 22, means patient is having metabolic acidosis. The primary component is alkalosis, means patient primary component is respiratory alkalosis, and which is compensated by the metabolic acidosis. And compensation as per expectations. Sir, basic thing is to calculate the pH and whether it is the primary component and whether it is a secondary component, and to look at the oxygenation level.
Great.
So next example is this patient is having pH 7.2. The 45-year-old male admitted to the hospital with acute intestinal obstruction with 3 days history of polyuria. The patient is having pH 7.2, PaCO2 25. pH is 7.2 means patient is acidosis. PaCO2 25 means patient is having respiratory alkalosis. Bicarb is 10, means patient is having metabolic acidosis. So primary component become metabolic acidosis. The compensating component is respiratory alkalosis. And next step is to calculate the ionic gap, sodium minus bicarb plus chloride level. The sodium is 131 and chloride is around 100. 100 plus 10, 110 means ionic gap is around 20. So patient is having high ionic gap acidosis. So concluding, the ABG is simple, easily repeatable bedside test. It is useful in diagnosis of acid base and respiratory disorder. The basic interpretation allow adequate diagnosis to be reached, and it is useful to assess the prognosis of the disease process, and we should always correlate ABG report with patient clinical condition. Thank you.
Yes, sir. After the interpretation of this respiratory metabolic acidosis, sir. How do we manage this respiratory acidosis?
The patient is having respiratory acidosis, means PaCO2 is more than 40. And patient is in respiratory distress. If patient is awake and having respiratory distress, first thing is we also give respiratory support like CPAP or pressure support mode of ventilation. If it's better to do ABG after 30 to 40 minutes of doing any respiratory intervention to assess your response to your treatment. If patient is responding to your treatment, then you can go ahead with your treatment of management. If patient is not responding or worsening, then you have to intubate this patient to manage the respiratory component.
For
metabolic acidosis, first thing you have to know the causes of metabolic acidosis. If a patient is having septic shock, and patient is having septic shock, and patient is on high inotropic support, and lactate is 9. Patient is having lactic acidosis. The best thing is to start with the antibiotic and circulatory support with any vasopressor agent. And you have to repeat ABG every 2 hourly to see your response to your treatment of treatment. Bicarb correction is very debatable topic. People used to say if PS falls less than 7.1, then you should give the bicarb. if pH is more than 7.1, there is no need to give backup. You have to treat the primary cause first, and then you support the backup level.
One more thing, sir. When we do the ABG and BBG, there's only certain difference, one or two differences, like in saturation, PaO2 and PCO2. Mm-hmm. So if we want to repeat the ABG again and again, we need to have an artery light.
Yes, sir.
Can we do a BBG instead of ABG for further to see the progression of disease?
If patient's lung is okay and patient is only having metabolic disturbance, you can do BBG, but we have to do serial BBG monitoring to see the response.
For respiratory component, BBG is more equivalent to BBG is equivalent in terms of lactate. You can measure lactate now.
We can do BBG, but ideally.
No, ideal settings ABG is always there. But if there is no availability of the arterial line, repeated, we don't want to puncture the radial artery or something else, then we can serial monitor. We can do the serial monitoring of lactate in VBG.
Yeah, we can
but
do
not respiratory parameters.
Yeah, yeah. We can monitor metabolic component, but we can't monitor the
respiratory component. For respiratory component, you always need ABG. But on metabolic component, you can compare ABG versus BBG.
We can compare the serial ABG report, and we can have a rough idea if patient is responding or not to your line of treatment.
So if your main purpose to do the repeated BBG or ABG is for metabolic component, then you can do it.
This can be better is to do not ABG. Ideally, better is second choice alternate. If patient is not in arterial line or anything.
Yes. So, Dr. Ganesh, I think what we have learned, and I think it's a very informative and a very useful class, is how to analyze, interpret, and come to a diagnosis. So you come to a diagnosis of what is the primary, and whether it is single or dual or multiple acid-based panels. But I guess as Monil's questions and others would have pointed out to you, I think everybody here is interested in how do we correct it.
Sir,
so maybe what I'm trying to say is that maybe I think it's up to Professor Kapoor, but probably a second class as a follow-up to this, in which you specifically take 3 or 4 problems and tell us how to correct them.
Yes, sir.
But I think the clinician is looking at easy answer. If it means intubation, ventilation, dialysis, and all that all needs to be done. But can we at the bedside give bicarb? You told us the rule of thumb is correct the primary disorder and give bicarb only if less than 7.1 pH. Now, I think most people actually, very many clinicians follow active correction of bicarbonate rather than resorting or at least interim to try and correct bicarbonate. So what is the proper way to correct? Similarly, when there is multiple disorders, and the primary disorder needs correction, while the secondary is not to be corrected. It will correct itself.
It will correct itself.
The primary has to be addressed.
Primary has to be addressed.
So my suggestion would be that if you can think of structuring 3 or 4 cases,
start from the
beginning.
I would suggest that take some real life cases.
Real life cases.
Take examples from the transplant intraoperatively, how ABG changed and what intervention you did. And maybe you can take 1 or 2 cases which deteriorated in the ICU or in the ward.
So our success,
that can be best.
So what we did step by step, what was the outcome and how things can be done optimally. Okay.
Sir, that would be very useful. We can get same ABG report in many different conditions. Like you can get 7.2 pH lactate in cardiogenic shock also. You can get septic shock also. You can
fully agree.
You can.
So in a given patient, and I think dealing with problems that the surgeons commonly encounter.
How to manage this patient?
In a medical ICU or in a nephrology ICU where the conditions would be different, primary conditions would be different. Perioperative, post-operative problems, which I'm sure you must be tackling very regularly.
Two major problems. One is the metabolic acidosis in our setup, which you can drain or ischemia. And second is when patient goes into respiratory
problems.
So if you can take these two examples and show the serial ABGs and what was done, either retrospective or from now, suppose you get a case where there are wide fluctuations in ABG, that will be a good teaching activity.
I think request you, maybe you can request Dr. Avinash. The presentation that Dr. Ganesh has made is very detailed and it is very difficult. But at one go and at one listening, people can understand everything. So having this presentation available and residents should go over it, they'll probably come up with more questions for Dr. Ganesh.
Yeah.
But we need then a very little lag between the presentation and the PPT being put up for residents to download and to study it, preferably before the next week's presentation. So that I think then questions can then come in follow-up on the WhatsApp group and the previous speaker can answer. So this is a complex subject. And unless people concentrate on what has been conveyed, it is very difficult to offhand ask questions on the topic. That is my request.
So, Avinash, are you there?
Probably voting generation.
Okay.
Voting generation.
Avinash?
Voting generation. Probably.
Hello.
So we are concluding today's clinical activity. Thank you all. Thank you for connecting. Thank you for connecting for this class.
Achha.